Okay, so I will, the PDE is mentioned in the title of the conference. So my knowledge of PDE is rather thin, but nevertheless quite narrow. So I will start with that one. So here is let's consider a function or a system of functions like this, and then we can take the gradient of the function, which is a matrix, and then we can take the determinant of that matrix, which is called the Jacobian. I suppose you are fairly familiar with something like this. So now what we would like to, if we are given an F, and then we would like to find an unknown U so that this is satisfied, so this is a first order PDE. Well, you can pretty quickly convince yourself that there is not much hope of having a unique solution, but we might ask whether there is a solution at all for this one. So now let's see, suppose that this function here, or let's say the component functions, they are in the Sobolev space. We don't really care so much where the functions themselves are, but the important thing is that where the gradients are, so we consider the homogeneous first order Sobolev space, and let's say the integrability is some p times the dimension. So this is just to say that these guys are in L p times the dimension, and everything is global here. We are in RD. So now if this is the case, well, if you remember how the determinant is defined, so it's a linear combination of some default products of these guys. So if these ones are in here, so then if we are given the U, then we will find an F which will be in LP of RD. So now we could, since we are in this direction, it works fine. We might ask the kind of the converse question. Suppose that we are given a function F in LP of RD. Is it possible to find a system of functions here of which, computing the determinant of the gradient, we recover the given F? So this is a question. Given F, is there U such that? Okay, well, I don't know, but I will give some partial answer, or some positive evidence towards the fact that this might be the case. But by the way, this question was asked actually. So I was not the, I'm not the first one to ask about this. So this was asked, and actually so asked by Tadeusz Iwaniec in a paper of 1997, and in fact he conjectured that the answer should be yes. Moreover, in fact he conjectured that there should exist a continuous right inverse for this nonlinear operator from RD valued Sobolev space into LP, so there should exist. So okay, maybe I write it down. Conjectured, there exists some continuous E from LP such that the Jacobian of E of F is equal to F for all F in LP. And then in particular, this would mean that we have a solution, and somehow he suggested that this would be some kind of a fundamental solution of the Jacobian equation. Okay, so the question like this, there is actually some history going a few years before this question. So here actually I'm mainly interested in my p's between 1 and infinity. But there is a little history of this problem related to p equal to 1. And in this case, well, here somehow the mapping, so if we are given u, the fact that we get an f in LP is fairly trivial. Well, this, and in that, this direction, it also works if p is equal to 1. But if we would like to get the converse for p equal to 1, we actually have to observe that there is a stronger mapping property of the Jacobian. So then, in fact, so if we have u in here, then actually, well, this will be in L1, but it's a little bit better. There is some subtle cancellation. This one is actually in the Hardy space. And this is due to Koifman, Lyons, Meyer, and Semps in 1993. And since I probably refer to these four gentlemen a few times, so I will just write it like this. And okay, so they asked for this p equal to 1 question, they asked the converse whether you can always find, given a function in the Hardy space, whether you can find a system of functions in the Sobolev space such that by taking the Jacobian determinant you recover the given function. So they asked question given f. Given f, is there u? As a matter of fact, they asked the question in a little bit different form. They didn't write the homogeneous Sobolev space, but just the Sobolev space. And well, that's somehow the, if the answer to that one is correct, of course, then in particular there is one in the homogeneous space, because that's asking a little bit less. But now only very recently we know that this homogeneous question is the only one which has the hope of having a positive answer. So actually they in fact asked the question whether you can find a u in the actual Sobolev space, where you'll ask that both the function and the gradient are in LP D of RD. But this one, so the inhomogeneous problem has a negative answer. And in fact, it has a very strong negative answer. This was only found fairly recently by Lindberg in a paper published last year. So what he showed that is that, well, not only, yeah, let me, so there it's a, so it's a strong negative answer. So it's basically, let me write it in this form. So even if you allow a little bit more, if you allow that your function is not just a Jacobian of something, but maybe a convergent series of Jacobians of something, even then you will have a, so if you ask that, the inhomogeneous Sobolev norms, so this is the LD norm plus the LD norm of the gradient, that this one converges. Well, clearly this set contains all functions of this form, but even this larger set has first category in H1, so it is a countable union of nowhere dense sets. So it's not only it's not all of H1, but it's a rather small subset of H1 in the sense of bare category. And by the way, this result also justifies why to consider the homogeneous question in the LP. So this is true for p equal to 1, but basically the same method. If I just put p here, so then this is the corresponding set has first category in LP for p between 1 and infinity. So it's no hope of finding for an arbitrary given LP function in the inhomogeneous Sobolev space, but maybe in the homogeneous Sobolev space. Very roughly speaking, the idea of the proof is just somehow that the proof is more complicated. It's a little bit tricky to use this observation, but basically the basic observation is just that this kind of that the second factor, the homogeneous factor, scales correctly with respect to the desired norm of the target space, and this one somehow scales incorrectly. And by exploiting this mismatch of the scaling of the two factors, he can prove this result. Okay. So something. What is known about them? So this is a strong negative answer. In the case p equals 1, there is also something positive is known, and this goes back to the Koifman and others. So I move this. Let's put this all the way up. Okay, so p equals 1. Positive result. And this is from the same paper of Koifman, Lyons, Meyer, and Sems. So, and it's actually somehow, a positive answer in the same spirit as the negative answer. So for all Hardy functions, there exists in the homogeneous. Actually, you can take these ones. Well, let me write it like this. This is the relevant, but you can even take them C infinity compactly supported. The main point is such that F is the sum of these ones, and I mean, you can the functions themselves in the expansions can be in the, you can choose them to be in the inhomogeneous Sobolev space even better than that. But the point is that the convergence of this controlling series, which of course this one, the L1 or even the H1 norm of this one is controlled by this one. You can only require the convergence of this one for the homogeneous norm. So every F can be expanded in this way, but not in the, only very few F can be expanded in the other with the convergence of the stronger controlling norms. So this is a positive result for p equal to 1, and now, but even for p equals 1, it's not known if we can just take the one term of the series. So what I want to study now in the direction of this question is getting a similar result for p bigger than 1. How could we possibly prove this? So let's look a little bit how they prove the p equals 1 case. So the proof of this result is based on a functional analytic lemma. Let me copy it just to be on the safe side. So V is a symmetric and bounded subset of a Banach space. So then the following are equivalent. Maybe let me actually write first what we want. So for all x in X, there are vectors vk in V scalars alpha k such that X is the sum of alpha k, or the series of alpha k vk and this one is finite. And the second one, so this is what we want. Basically, the set V consists of the Jacobians of mappings like mappings in the homogeneous Sobolev space or with the homogeneous norm controlled by 1. X would be either the Hardy space or in the LP version, the LP space. So what is the condition that we need to check? The condition is that this set V should be norming for the dual space. I.e., if we take any element in the dual space, we can compute the dual space norm. Well, by definition, that's the supremum of this kind of quantities over the unit ball of X, but it suffices to somehow the set V has to be sufficiently rich for this kind of an that we can already compute the norm with the help of the just checking against the elements of this set V. So how the Koichman and others proved this representation was by checking this kind of a norming condition. And by the way, there is somehow a little addition to this. So also the negative result is based on the same functional analytic lemma or a little extension of that one. So this was observed by Lindberg that in the case that these conditions fail, they fail miserably. So if you cannot represent every x, you can actually represent only a subset of the first category. Okay, but so now we would like to go for the positive result. So we would like to have this kind of a norming property. So we want that if we take B, well, in the dual of LP, then this should be recover this by taking L P D smaller than or equal to 1. Okay, I've spent the first 20 minutes, so we should move towards the commutators. Maybe you are curious to see where the commutators enter the picture. So that's coming now. So actually, in addition to proving this negative result, Lindberg also sketched a possible approach to the positive result in the special case when we are in dimension 2. So in the special case when we are in dimension two, there is an interesting relation between the Jacobian and the commutators. So in dimension d equal to 2. Okay, so then it's the determinant of it's a reasonably explicit computation, and now we are in dimension 2, we can use complex variable framework, so we write h as the complex version of this vector u, and then we use this these complex derivatives, and then we doing a little bit of algebra, we find that this is the complex derivative of h absolute value squared minus the d bar derivative of h absolute value squared. And then we do a little bit of more complex variables, so there is a wonderful singular integral called the Alfors Berling transform. Well, maybe I first write it here. So there is a singular integral operator which sends this d bar derivative into the d derivative. So here SF. So it's like the two-dimensional version of the Hilbert transform where we integrate with respect to the, so it's just a Lebesgue, two-dimensional Lebesgue measure in the complex plane, no path integrals here. So now if my h, if my u is in the Sobolev space dp, and now d is equal to 2, so then my h, which is the, well, h is still going to be in there, but then the d bar of h, so h is going to be in the same space, but d bar of h is going to be in L 2 over p. Let's see which letter I didn't use yet. So let's call this one, let's call it V. So somehow we are now getting rid of this Sobolev stuff. We are coming to LP spaces and singular integrals, so to the harmonic analysis side of the business. So we have a singular integral, a nice singular integral operator acting on an LP or L2P function. And okay, so that's our expression. And now we would like to see that we want this kind of a norming property. So we are testing the, okay, so this is the, we are given an LP prime function, and the question mark is whether we can compute its norm where we are. Okay, here u is in the Sobolev 1-2p space. Okay, so by the computation that I just did, this would be the same as asking, I have my v in the L2p space, I have the integral of b and sv squared minus v squared. And if I do a little polarization, I can actually allow myself two different v's in the same space. And I have sv times sw bar minus v times w bar. It's clear that, well, one direction is clear and also the other direction is not difficult. It's kind of like a standard polarization. But now, the Berlin Alfors operator, it's not only bounded on L, on any reflexive LP, it's also actually an isomorphism, so it's invertible. So if I denote this one by G, of course I'm asking them to be not just in this space but in the unit ball of this space, always of norm at most one in this, in whichever space I write. But essentially, if W is taken from the unit ball of this space, it's essentially the same as asking this G to be in the unit ball of this space. Okay, maybe I write here the unit balls. So up to some constants, it's still the same as having these ones in the unit ball. And then it's B SV times G minus B times V. And okay, now I need to do a little computation. So I have that. So SW bar is G, so SW is G bar, and then W is, so S star is now the complex linear dual of S. So this is true. This one is the inverse of S, the complex linear dual of S, and therefore W bar is this one. So now in this second half of the integral, I'm just using the complex linear duality, so I move the S over here. So I have B S V times G minus S acting on B times V times G bar bar, which is just G. So now what is this? Maybe I take the G in front, and then there is B times S acting on V minus S acting on B times V. So that's what we call the commutator of B and S. And I'm taking the supremum over all V and G in this space. So it's the same supremum. So now what is this? This is the norm of this commutator. So starting from L2P, not going to L2P because we compute the norm by dualizing against something in the unit ball of the dual space. So we are actually computing the norm of this operator from L2P into L2P prime. That's what we want. And maybe let's just notice a little. Let's notice two things. The same computation is also valid for P equal to 1. So if P is equal to 1, then we have just the norm of the commutator from L2 into L2. And this is a classical result, going back to Kaufmann, Rochberg and Weiss. I could check, probably it's about 1976. this is equivalent to the BMO norm of B. And BMO is the dual space of H1, so that's how one checks this required norming condition in the case when P is equal to 1. And then in companion with this functional analytic lemma, that's basically how one gets the Koifman, Lyons, Meyer, Sems result. But now we have P bigger than 1. So this means in particular that 2P is bigger than 2, is bigger than 2P prime. So we are willing to, somehow we would need to know, when does it happen that the commutator maps an LP space into another LP space with a smaller exponent? So what do we know about this? Okay, let's see. Restart from this side. So let me give you a theorem which answers this. Parts of this are kind of classical, parts of it are new. Okay. I will just state it for the sake of simplicity for this Berling operator. I think in the end I will maybe say something about other Calderon-Sigmund operators. Okay, so now we have, well, we want a particular case with 2p and 2p prime, but let's see what happens for general exponents in the reflexive range. So we have exponents in this range, and suppose that we are given a locally integrable function. Maybe now it's on the complex plane because into R2 because that's the natural setting for the Berling operator. So then the commutator, so just for maybe let's write it once more. So it's an operator which maps a function f into b times s of f minus s acting on b times f is bounded from LP to LQ, if and only if. There will be four cases. So one case is that P is equal to Q and B is a BMO function. Or, and this is pretty much classical. Another possibility is that P is smaller than Q, but somehow not too much smaller. So Q is at most the Sobolev exponent. Okay, maybe I write, so here D is equal to 2, but just to, so if I'm dividing by 0, I understand that this is infinity and the case is valid for any q bigger than p, but otherwise it extends only up to this point. So if we are in this range, then we must have that b is alpha Hölder continuous for alpha, which is d times, let's see, p is smaller, so 1 over p is bigger for this exponent. But by the way, this condition here is exactly the condition that this Hölder exponent is at most 1. then there is a kind of a, what happens if Q is somehow too much bigger than P? It's kind of allowed, but only very rarely. So the commutator can map into much higher Q, but only if B is a constant. So it can map into a higher, much higher Q only if it maps sort of trivially, because it maps everything to zero. But that's also an admissible case. Okay, but so somehow, I think all this was basically, all this is basically, this is somehow the classical cases. But notice that now we didn't really touch so far the case that we really care about here when we map into a smaller exponent. So that's somehow the new case, which didn't seem to be considered before. So if Q is smaller than P, then B equals A plus C, where A is in LR, and somehow one has to figure out again the correct order. So Q is smaller, so 1 over Q is bigger. It's like this. And C is a constant. So that's kind of a complete picture of the mapping properties of these commutators. Okay, let's say a little bit about this. So it's if and only if. And this is kind of an interesting theorem, especially the point delta, because somehow usually when you characterize the boundedness of something, the boundedness is of an operator is supposed to be a difficult thing, and then you would like to characterize it by something easier. So somehow, usually in this kind of theorems, you would expect that if you know the boundedness, then all the characterizing conditions are somehow easy consequences. But now, at least in some of these cases, it's the other way around. So let's look a little bit about this. So we have the if direction. So suppose we are in the have condition alpha, beta, gamma, or delta, we want to prove the boundedness. Well, for alpha, this is I would say that this is the only really non-trivial case of this if direction. So this is I will not there are several proofs. It's not super hard, but it's also not completely trivial. So this goes back to Koifman, Rothberg, and Weiss. There are now by now several proofs of this. It's not trivial, also not super hard, but I will not say more about this one. But what about the other? Let's say the condition beta. So suppose we have an alpha Herder continuous function B, and we would like to actually maybe I will do this. This is instead of S, let me write a general Caudron Sigmund operator, because this argument is not at all harder in that case. So we have, so the operator T is like this. Then if we multiply by bx, well, it's constant with respect to this integration, we can put the bx inside, and in the other term we first multiply it by b here, so it's a b of y, but inside the integral we can equally well move the, well, this is basically the expression for the commutator. And now why is this case easy? Well, it's easy because somehow you can do something which you usually are not allowed to do, which is the first somehow the cardinal mistake, the game over move in any consideration of the singular integral, but here you can do it. So you just put the absolute values inside. okay, I just, well, it's a short argument. Maybe I finish it here. So you have the Hölder continuity. So you have x minus y to power alpha. You have the usual kernel bound. So you have x minus y to power dimension, and you have f y dy. So here is a positive alpha. So this is a well-known fractional integral operator acting a positive kernel fractional integral operator, and the mapping LP to LQ mapping properties of this are very well known, and they exactly coincide with the condition that was stated here. So if alpha is like this, then the fractional integral maps LP into LQ, and there our commutator is dominated by this one. And okay, so then we have in gamma and delta, if b is a constant function, then the commutator is zero, so that's trivial. Also in delta, well, we can split it into two parts. In the constant part, again, the commutator is trivial, so we conclude. And if we are in there, and if b is an LR function, well, that's also sort of trivial, because you don't really need to do anything. You just use the fact that you know that your Calderon-Sigmund operator, in particular this Alfors-Berling transform, is bounded both in LP and in LQ, and then you use Hölder's inequality. So in the case gamma, and we consider this AT of F in LQ. Yeah, so again, somehow, why this is basically trivial, because you don't use any cancellation between the two terms. The minus sign plays no role. You just do it like this. Then you use Hölder, you get this one, and here you use the boundedness of T in LQ, and here you use the boundedness of T in LP, and here you use Hölder. And then you just get the AR and the sum of the norms of T in LP and in LQ. By the way, this computation is perfectly valid also if P is equal to Q, and then you recover somehow a trivial special case of alpha, that if B is an L-infinity function, then the commutator is bounded. But in the alpha case, the non-trivial part is that you can do it. You can do better. There are more admissible functions than the L-infinity functions. This was the case delta. So now, as I said, so except for the case alpha, which is classical, all the if directions, in particular the if direction in the case that we care about, are fairly trivial. The only issue is really the only if direction. And on the other hand, maybe precisely for the reason that the if direction is so trivial, the only if direction is kind of slightly surprising. Why is it that you couldn't get more functions by exploiting some cancellation between the two terms? So somehow the theorem says that in this regime of exponents, there is no cancellation to help you. You can only prove the boundedness for the objects for which you can do it somehow trivially. Okay, so let's see what are my chances of doing something about them. Something about the proof. Maybe I will at least try. So we come to the only if parts. Actually, it could be that in the worst case I can just reprove the classical cases, but even this will give some flavor of what is going on. So in the classical case, we would like to estimate the BMO norm. So we take in any ball, we take the average integral, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so we would like to somehow make this more linear. So there is some function of absolute value 1, so that this this absolute value is the function itself times the sigma. And then I also write this average as an integral, so then I end up with a double average integral bz minus b y sigma z dz dy. And well, you can already see it's starting to look a little bit like the commutator. Well, how do we make it exactly like a commutator? So we want to have this is the kernel of my transform, but then of course I also have to put it here. And now, okay, no, so now I'm in the special case of the Berling operator. So now this is a proof by magic. One has to, in the general case, one has to work a little bit harder. But now this is just a polynomial. Let me add and subtract. So C is the center point of the ball. And okay, this is a this splits into three functions, which are simple functions that are products of something in functions of z and functions in y. So now, okay, so I have a sum of three functions, and maybe let me write one of the average integrals. So now I'm doing some, so I have here, I have b. And okay, so this one here is the kernel of the commutator. So if I remove the average integral, this will be, so just consider the integral, this will be precisely the first, let's say the inner integral will be the commutator acting on some function fi. So for example, depending on I, it could be just the, if I take the product of this one and this one, then fi is just the constant, the indicator of the ball. In the second case, it will be this function times the indicator of the ball, and in the third case, this function of y times the indicator of the ball. So I have this one, after the y integration, I have this one at the point z, and then I have another function zi, again, depending on which case we are in. So this is basically a pairing, the commutator acting on one function and paired against another function. And I should observe a little bit about the scaling. So somehow I put one measure I've wrote explicitly. I'm also dividing by the other measure. I'm dividing by the Lebesgue measure of the ball, and we are in two dimensions, so that's basically r squared. And each of them is, c is the center of the ball, this is at most the radius away from the ball. So if I divide these ones by the measure of the ball, I get something which is normalized in L1. So here I have, so fi, gi have L infinity norms less than or equal to 1, and they are supported in the particular ball. So that's what we get. So now from here, it's actually, if we want to prove any of the classical cases, it's sort of straightforward, because we just need to do this in one ball. We estimate up, so we have the measure of the ball, we have the norm of the commutator from LP to LQ, then we have the LP norm of, okay, there is still the sum over I, but it's a finite sum, LP norm of FI, LQ norm, LQ prime norm of GI, and these are L infinity normalized, so this is just the measure of the ball to power 1 over P, this is the measure of the ball to power 1 over Q prime. If P is equal to Q, these sum up to 1, and cancel with this one, and we just derive that the BMO norm is bounded by the norm of the commutator. So we have this one, and then we have 1 over p plus 1 over q prime minus 1, so it's actually 1 over p minus 1 over q prime, and this is radius to power dimension times 1 over p minus 1 over q, which is radius to power alpha, in the case when alpha is greater than 0. This is, in that case, this is a known characterization of the, somehow one can characterize the Hölder continuity by a BMO type condition. So it's maybe it's on a first look not exactly the Hölder condition, but it's an equivalent condition to this one. Okay, but this was just somehow basically recalling how the classical cases are proved. So now very quickly, what do we do about the when we are mapping into a smaller exponent, and then we would like to estimate the LR norm of our function B. Maybe I cheat a little bit so I can be faster. So, okay, eventually we want to estimate the function globally, but let's do it somehow a local version where we fix a very large cube Q0, and then there is a wonderful pointwise bound. It has been exploited quite a bit in particular in the weighted business recently. Actually, one doesn't even, so there is a formula of André Lerner, but actually what I need is not really the formula of André Lerner. It's somehow an ancestor of this one, which certainly goes back to Calderon and Sigmund, because I don't need any median oscillation. It's just a plain oscillation. So maybe to stress the fact that this is a pointwise inequality between functions, let me write the. So here I have the function bx, but on the right hand side I have only averages. So the only x dependence is in the indicator function. So given a cube q0, I can dominate it by this kind of a sum where this is basically just the iterating the Calderon-Sigmund decomposition. So here this qj's is a countable family of so-called sparse subcubes of q0, sparse meaning essentially disjoint or disjoint up to some error terms, but let's think of them just as being disjoint subcubes, which is not quite correct, but correct enough for any LP estimates. Okay, so then we would like to estimate the LR norm of this one. So it's the LR norm of this one, and now, as I said, so these are sparse, which means essentially as if they are disjoint. So if they are disjoint, I would have what I write here, and this is up to some constant. It's also true in the sparse case. So I have the measure of the set and the value of the function on that set. And now it's convenient to, let's see, is it convenient to, yes, it is convenient to dualize this one. So this is a little LR norm, and now I dualize it with a sequence in the dual, in the weighted with the measures of this qj's space. And by the way, now conveniently why I chose this weight is that now this qj and the average integral cancel out. Let's see, what do I do? Maybe I move back here because that's the That's the quickest. That's the quickest way. Okay, so I have so sum over J, lambda J, and just QJ B minus BQJ. And well, okay, here I wrote a ball, but the same computation is also perfectly valid if I have a Q. So, and by the way, yeah, now I'm using this compute, so I have an average here and I have an average here, but now I just use it by removing the average from both sides, which is obviously also true by multiplying by the measure. So I just proved that this such an integral is dominated by, now I extend the integral over the whole space by assuming that these functions are, the supports are restricted on the QJ. So I have BS FJ times GJ. Maybe I'm dropping the I summation or let's say I'm subsuming the I summation into the J summation. So in any case, the I summation is just finite, so that doesn't make a big difference. Okay. And now, this is a sum over an infinite collection of cubes, and fj and gj are certain functions supported on the jth cube and with the L infinity normalization. So I'm happy I got this far. I'm doing a trick which I think some of my friends will like. So somehow I decouple the, I write epsilon j fj. So this one is acting on the sum, and then I multiply it by another similar sum with the g case. And when I take the expectation, so these are independent random signs, so only the diagonal terms survive, and they give exactly this one. Well, not exactly, maybe you observe that I forgot about the lambdas. So now I have to somehow distribute the lambdas nicely into this one and this one. And how I do this one is, okay, so I take lambda j to some power here and lambda k to some power here. And the powers basically come from the, where do they come from? So remember that 1 over r is 1 over q minus 1 over p, so therefore 1 over r prime is 1 minus this, so it's 1 over q prime plus 1 over p, so therefore 1 is equal to r prime divided by q prime plus r prime divided by p. And these are the exponents that I want to this is supposed to be an L estimated in LP, so I write here R prime divided by P, and this is supposed to be estimated in LQ prime. I write R prime over Q prime here, and then I have the norm of this one from LP to LQ, and I have the LP norm of this object and the LQ prime norm of this object, and somehow using all the information that we have about the supports of the function and the normalization of the functions, this actually boils down to essentially constant. So this is the estimate. And then this was an estimate valid in any big cube, so then I just consider a sequence of cubes and which exhaust everything and use Fatou lemma or something like this, and I derive precisely the, it turns out that the averages in bigger and bigger cubes approach a constant, and then I precisely derive what I claimed, that B minus some constant is an LR function, and the LR norm is estimated by the norm of the commutator. So just maybe final two sentences. So this was a proof by magic, by using the special properties of the kernel. But working harder, one can prove two extensions, or actually several extensions. But among them, this one is true for any sufficiently non-degenerate Calderon-Sigmund operator. And as I said, or it was Lindberg's idea that from this commutator theorem, one proves the estimate for the Jacobian in two dimensions. But it turns out that once one has this idea of the proof, so instead of using the theorem, but redoing the proof for the Jacobian, one also gets the result about the Jacobian in any dimension, not as a corollary of the theorem, but somehow by recycling the ideas from its proof. But I better stop here. Thank you.
Oh, maybe not.
So when you go to the Calderon-Sigmund operators, do you use then the decomposition over cubes?
Let me say so. Somehow, actually, this end of the argument is pretty much the same in the general case. So the trick is that somehow one has to justify that this average is dominated by the commutator acting on some functions. So somehow this part of the proof is actually very generic. One has to, here in the general case, when this algebraic magic is not available, one has to work somewhat harder to get. So one somehow has to identify. But basically the point is that when you need to assume somehow that the Calderon-Sigmund operator is sufficiently non-degenerate, and then you can do kind of the same thing. You divide and multiply by the kernel, but then one needs to work a little bit more carefully in this one. But it's really this computation which requires some additional work in that case.
Yeah. Thank you. So this conjecture that you stated in the very beginning of the talk, do you think it would be possible to solve with some kind of interpolation theorem somehow?
I cannot completely exclude it, but I don't really have an idea of between what to interpolate.
Yeah, okay, so there's no point to interpolate between, that's a problem.
Well, that's at least one of the problems. So somehow the problem about really having the solvability. Well, okay, there are some. Okay, so actually maybe. So there could be a point. So there is what I didn't mention. So I mean, this equation has been studied, and there are some results about the solvability in higher smoothness classes. So when both the data is a Hölder continuous function and you ask a solution that is a Hölder continuous, or you are in a Sobolev space with high enough indices so that they embed into continuous functions. So in this kind of regime, there are some results about the solvability of the Jacobian. So that could, so if you are, yeah, so that could possibly be one point, but then even then it would be at most some extrapolation. There is not the obvious other endpoint of, there is actually some positive, could be an interesting idea. I don't know how to, it's because there, in fact, there are also some results about the solvability when p is smaller than one. So it's actually not completely out of question that something could be, but in any case, there is a bit of non-linearity and so on to overcome. But
questions, then